It's also worth noting, both Yoshi and Pac-Man, while these two players are character specialists through and through, both of these characters have seen a lot of growth here in Ultimate, from their kits finding more strength to even the results as a whole. Because alongside Suarez, he has Raptor and Meme from Mexico, proving that this is a character that's worthy of note. And of course, Sinji, you get to look at the likes of T and Kiwi, who are also helping put this character on the board as a viable threat. Sure, they may be very unorthodox in the grand scheme of Smash, and especially the meta, but when it comes to knowing these characters, there is no better.
Just look at Sinji's play already. Got a Galaga conversion early on, but didn't convert off of that, and has just been bullying Suarez with all the various fruit and items he has at his disposal.
Now, I'm especially worried for Suarez in this particular match because there is no other Pac-Man in New York like Sinji. Hell, you can even say there is no other Pac-Man like Sinji. All of the top-level Pac-Man players are very different in how they take
it's
their spins on their tools. Look at the patience on that. Sinji knew at that level of percentage how and when he needed to put out that forward smash. It's that kind of awareness that Suarez has to be, that he has to be careful of.
Yeah, even, I'm glad that you mentioned that because, of course, one of our more local players, Kiwi, and, you know, on occasion, Kool-Aid, when he's being Kool-Aid, but...
We don't talk about Kool-Aid.
You know, but the way they play Pac-Man is all very different, which is weird because for kind of like a... I'd consider him a projectile type of character, right? More or less, but they play them in such different ways. You would think that a character like this would be more streamlined, but no. There are different approaches you can take to this character. If you want to play him aggressive, you can.
I feel like it's because the item play around bonus fruit invites such a big variety in how you handle the character. You can know what all of them do, the angles they're thrown, the time it takes to charge them, what follow-ups you get, but how you take that approach is so freeform. And I feel like Sinji is so methodical in what he does with these tools that it's no surprise that if you're not well studied in how he has his take on these tools, it's always going to be an uphill battle, and that's where Suarez is finding himself right now, because he's even struggling just to put on damage to Sinji.
Yeah, and it's even looking like in scenarios, okay, no tech, but he should be fine still. Yeah, can do it twice, grab, no, doesn't even grab ledge, makes it back on stage. Looks like even he was a little bit surprised at that. But for Sinji, you know, Raptor, Suarez, can't seem to find himself a way to get in. That's going to be hard against a projectile character, but also with the way that Sinji uses Hydrant, it's kind of like Zelda's Phantom. He puts it right in front of him, and he uses it to tank hits. If you aren't looking at the percentages that you're doing for the Hydrant, you're not going to know when it's going to fly.
Yeah, knowing how to deal with Hydrant, and specifically what moves in your kit can affect it well, and especially what angles they send out, is pivotal to being able to fight Pac-Man. But it just goes to show a level of character knowledge that's absent in a lot of players, and right now I feel like that's what I'm seeing out of Suarez. It doesn't seem like he knows what to do against these kind of tools, and Sinji feasts upon players who don't know what they're up against.
Pac-Man, if there's any character to feast on players who don't know what they're, what's going on, is Pac-Man, man. He'll waka-waka all over your face, and a large, it just has so much. Right, it's like, I have this fruit, and that fruit, and this fruit, and that fruit. And he's another one of those characters where when you're playing the game, if you want to be able to contest him properly, you are likely going to need to be looking at Pac-Man. It's kind of like Snake. If you want to contest Snake, you probably want to have your eyes on Snake and not your own character so you can follow him along the screen.
Right. Game 2 is going to be bringing this to Smash, and I actually like this because I feel like Sinji had controlled the previous stage very well. It was very difficult for Suarez to get in, making things a little bit more of tighter corners. It's going to not only help with being able to actually move inwards onto Sinji, but it's going to help with being able to limit the amount of space that gets controlled by Bonus Fruit and Fire Hydrant.
And that's another thing that's really difficult for Suarez to deal with as well. In a lot of the other matchups, he can kind of use the egg toss to contest a lot of the projectiles other characters have. But against someone like Pac-Man, the eggs just straight up lose or gets tanked by the Hydrant, which really limits him. Sometimes he likes to bounce the eggs off the stage. He doesn't have that option anymore because of the Hydrant.
Just like that, another situation. Forward air, it's not going to be able to do enough in one swing. towards the fire hydrant. Forward smash does, and it just helps extend that just a little bit more and keep another active hitbox. Ooh, the Z-drop bell too, help occupy space. One thing we've seen Suarez do a couple of times, which I actually really like, and I'm waiting to see if it pays off for him, is how he's attempting to grab the power pellet line with Peg Leg.
Wondering as well, could we be able to make that connection? It's just hard. Even sometimes, some people see a Yoshi's go for it. Whoa, he's really deep out there, and he manages to find it, puts out the boot, the one strong Tim. Shout out to Long Island, baby. New York is in full effect.
Listen, we need those Sims out in the island just as much as you need them in the city. That's where we get all the snow and dirt. But listen, Suarez has still got a lot of work ahead of him. He's catching on to a few of Sinji's tricks, but this man's pockets go deep. You know he's got so much planned for Suarez. And even though sitting at 141 is scary, Suarez has to make his stock less just so he can gather more information, put down just a little bit more percentage, and maintain that this battle is going to be a hard-fought one on both sides.
Yeah. Oh, the hydrant being absolutely clutch for Suarez because of how it pushed him away from that smash attack from Sinji. Sinji probably didn't even recognize, wouldn't even matter, only to what, 6% because of that maybe, if even. So not a huge deal, Suarez not really able to take that to full advantage, but, oh man.
All right, I see you, Suarez. Finding your spots where you can get your hits, trying to make these edge guards last. I like it a lot, especially considering how variable Sinji's tools are when he wants to return to the stage. Be it the armor from the power pellet, or possibly what he can do with trampoline. There's a lot here, and that would have been a hell of a read. Slow down, man.
Takes a little bit of a ride with the hydrant. Slides off the stage and go ahead and shield that other hydrant as well. But Sinji, it's like the moment Suarez drops his shield and starts to try and move in on the area that Sinji is occupying. Sinji's already out of there.
Speaking of out of it, Suarez is shaking his head. He's not happy with it. He knew as soon as he got up into that belt, it was not the right option to go for it. Hoping that he could shake it off ahead of time, but I think it's one of these matters where it's like he's not well prepared, so he's just going to try his best at this point. But Sinji's doing the same.
And I'm really happy that we saw Sinji roll out of that down beat. A lot of people end up holding shield, and oh, lo and behold, their shield ends up broken. We saw that even happen earlier. It wasn't the set that I was casting, but with somebody else that had their shield broken. And you can react. The moment he does the jump, you can roll in time. But you just have to be aware of it. Same thing with Bowser's. You just have to be aware.
Awareness is key in so many matchups, but I feel like with fighting Pac-Man, it's like you have to keep your eye on the ball, not just the character that you're fighting, but like what tool he has at his disposal. Know how to respond to it, and I feel especially the positioning. Like, the smash roll pick was great because it helped with changing up how Sinji was going to approach on Suarez, but now it's a matter of how well is Suarez going to be able to respond to where Sinji's positioning. He got it changed, yeah, but now it's still maintaining that battle, and it's looking just super hard for him now as Sinji manages to clinch out game two.
And for Suarez, he really has to think, right? Because Pac-Man is not actually a character that has an easy time killing. And especially, I remember games in Smash 4 where Sinji would go into timeout. He's had similar games even in Ultimate. He's probably timed people out at a local. I wouldn't be surprised or even been timed out because Pac-Man does struggle in that area. So for Sinji, he's like, okay, my win condition is first, rack up damage. Whether I'm using the Galaga or whatever speed I have at my disposal, rack up that damage, maybe get some up air conversions. Then when I start getting to the 100-ish ranges, that's when I start using that bell pepper and throwing it and saying, okay, cool, I got the stun, I can set up for the smash attack. Because getting them raw is very difficult unless you set up for a hard knockdown.
The bell itself is just such a useful tool, especially in this game, because now it's consistently acting as a safe confirm for kills no matter where on the stage. And it's so easy for Sinji to change up how he's using it. Whether it's the immediate throw out of the bonus fruit charge, or he has it in hand and he's going to use the item just as a regular item grabbed, there's so much variety in what's being offered. Coming into game three, we're back on Smash 4. I like the picks though. We've already seen Suarez is able to put immense amounts of damage onto Sinji. But I feel like now that Suarez has figured out how to put the damage on, his next step, he's got to figure out how to end these stocks because Sinji has always been able to live forever with Pac-Man. But that cannot happen. That's one way to do it.
Yeah. I'm like, wow, that's really one way to take something from somebody else and use it to your own advantage. Hitting the hydrant with the forward air, I believe, and it went at the perfect arc to smack Sinji out of the sky. Okay, he just kind of threw the bell away.
Yeah, I think his plan was to use the momentum from the water to be able to just grab it at the ledge, which I've seen Sinji do that a couple of times. That's nothing new for him. But this positioning, a bit of a rare occurrence with Sinji, something that Suarez needs to be able to take advantage of. It seems like this game really is starting to slip away. And of course, it's a great thing for Suarez, but I feel like he needs to take so much more advantage of it. Like, get aggressive, figure out the tools, force Sinji's hand, let him show all of his tricks. Because if he can just take this into game four, I think Suarez can take it.
I think you might be onto something with that, especially, you know, I am a little bit worried in terms of the counter picks that Sinji will have and what stages, I don't know, it's going to be scary just simply because of the fact I feel like this middle base platform has been doing a lot for Suarez, right? It allows him to kind of just ignore the hydrant and go over it and work around it, whereas in the other stages where the platforms are to the sides a little bit, he has to work his way through the middle. But this platform is giving him a lot of room to work with, and you likely won't have that if this goes to a game four.
That was a weird super jump. I'm not going to really be a fan of it, to be honest. I feel like the pressure might be building onto Sinji. While he normally is a lot more composed, this is still a high pressure situation. This is a top 8 qualifier, Flambo. This is making him from loser side, so this is do or die here. And even though it's Suarez who's down 2 on the 0-2, it's still a high pressure situation. Now they're both on last stock, not a lot of percentage built up onto Sinji. He's got to clutch this out if he wants to take the set 3-0.
And the second hit of the Galaga's the only one to connect, but it did 10% on its own, man. If it hit both, it probably would have been somewhere around 20, I'd imagine.
Bro, everybody forgets that characters in this game just deal damage, and that was always something that was a slow burn for Pac-Man, but in this game, he's still hitting hard. This character's got damage. Like, people gotta learn to respect. Great call out on the shield. We've seen Sinji playing on the shield a ton in this set, and now, close in egg lay.
Ooh, he lived? At the eye? I mean,
where are you
at? I don't know, because that move already sends an abysmal angle, but Sinji has another chance here to get the win, and you saw that forward smash almost two for him at the ledge. He's fighting back, rolls out again. Sinji almost making the comeback.
But Suarez is alive
no
for
way!
Now, and great DI is keeping him alive from the up smash, but he air dodged. It's a shame to see the boys hug it out, and Sinji secures his spot into top 8 through loser side.
Suarez. Again.
I'm sorry, I can't read German.
Again. Man.
Both of the Long Island Yoshis got 9th of this tournament. I couldn't be more proud of them, to be honest.
Yeah, I mean, just thinking, I'm sure, Devin, you can probably tell us, right, who our top 8 thus far is, because I know we've seen some of those qualifiers already, right?